Hey, Brent Pourciau, TopVelocity.net. This video is covering lower half science. So for throwing athletes, pitchers, going to be more specific to pitchers, but this will apply to other throwing positions. I say science because I want you to know it is science. I have a master's in kinesiology. I'm in my dissertation for my PhD in sports science. And unfortunately, I'm not very common in the industry. A lot of coaches out there don't have these certifications. The difference is you get a lot of theories and opinions. You don't get a lot of scientific principles. You don't even get a lot of scientific terminology, which would allow basically a better understanding of how all these methods differ or are different. Because if people are using more scientific terminology, then you can see how it's being applied in different methods. But if people are just out there making up their own terms, which we find a lot in baseball, it's very confusing. How are each one of them different? And unfortunately, the ones that are making up a lot of these terms that you don't see in scientific literature, then those are the ones that more than likely don't have the education. So just be aware of that, because there is a lot of like reinventing the wheel and a lot of like just real anecdotal understanding of how this works, meaning very heavy on opinions on what's going on, and it's very much void or lacks a true understanding of scientific principles and really how the universe, how we use the principles of the universe to apply movement like in throwing or pitching. So I want to start with a study, just because the studies are the best place to go, because the studies are information that have been gone through a scientific method, gone through empirical, or has collected evidence, empirical evidence, and have come to good conclusions. For example, this is the one I'm going to start off with, and it just kind of tells us about the function of the lower half. What is the function of the lower half as throwing athletes or as pitchers? And this study is peak horizontal ground reaction forces and impulse correlated with segmental energy flow in youth baseball pitchers. So impulse is basically the exertion of force, okay? So if I look here, the conclusion is peak propulsion ground reaction forces. So what are ground reaction forces? Forces that come out of the ground. That's the potential energy we have to move as athletes, is how we first interact with the ground. And this is of the drive leg. It correlated with energy flow. That's the energy moving through our body. That's probably the best way to understand how your mechanics are affecting performance, is energy flow. And this is into what's called the proximal segment. So that's within. So the proximal means like the core. So it's looking at the propulsion or peak propulsion of the ground reaction forces of the drive leg and its effects on energy flow into these segments. And it says, whereas peak braking ground reaction forces of the stride leg, that's the landing leg, those correlated with energy flow into the distal segment. So it was saying initially the drive leg's peak ground reaction forces was the connection to the energy moving through the core. And then the landing leg was directly correlated to those forces, to the energy moving out of the core into the distal segments, to the ball. So it's this pumping in and pumping out of the back leg, the front leg. It's key to how well you perform. So this study is basically showing us that's one of the most true functions of it. There's going to be several studies that look at how the drive leg must function. For example, this study called Stride Length Impacts Sagittal Knee Biomechanics in Flat Ground Baseball Pitching. So basically just how the extension of the knee works. And the findings suggest that shorter strides delay knee extension. That's this joint, right? Knee extension. Mechanics with concomitant increases in retrospective stride knee joint powers and bracing during the acceleration phase. So basically, I don't know why they use that word, but basically in its association to the powers of the landing knee. So the back knee extension time affects the power that you can create out of the front knee extension. Once again, go back to the previous study. The back leg pumps it in, front leg pumps it out. So it's basically saying if you're spending less time in the back knee in extending and driving, it's going to reduce the forces that you can create out of the front leg. That would only make sense, right? So basically, if I'm blocking and catching energy and pushing energy out, that energy that I'm pushing out and catching is going to be directly related to the energy the back leg is moving to the front leg. So the back leg is taking a shorter stride, it's moving less energy to the front leg, so you can have less energy to come out. If there's a lot of energy coming out the back leg or the front leg, then you're going to have a lot more energy you can push out, kind of the underlying theme, and it's talking about extension of the knee. So those who are spending less time extending the knee are going to have less energy to push out in the front leg, which kind of goes against those that tell you it's pure rotation. Well, if you're going to purely rotate, you're not going to get a lot of knee extension. Therefore, you're not going to be putting a lot of energy into the front leg, which you can then pump out of the front leg. There's a couple more. I'm going to go one more. I could go really heavy into more of the science, but we're starting to get a good understanding of how this works. This is called three-dimensional dynamic analysis for the lower extremity during fastball baseball pitch. The conclusion, ground reaction forces acting on the pivot, which is the drive leg, and the stride leg, which is the front leg in this study, and also the joint torques for both legs during a baseball pitch of the baseball could be identified. In this study, two major findings were concluded. The ground reaction forces were limited in two forces, namely anterior-posterior, which is back and forward, or forward and backward, and vertical forces, the up forces going up. The vertical ground reaction forces for the pivot leg, that back leg, that drive leg, mainly resulted from the knee and hip extension torques. Torques are forces, and it's torques because there is rotation. Even though it's extending, the joint is creating a rotational movement, but it's extending. That's just how anatomically the science identifies it. Whereas the forward ground reaction forces comes from the plantar flexion, that's the front leg extending, or not the front leg, that's the ankle extending torque. So basically saying the forces were coming out of the knee and hip extension and the ankle extension. So it's literally saying extension. So the vertical ground reaction forces for the pivot foot, which is the drive foot, mainly resulted from the knee, hip extension torques, and the plantar flexion torques. So basically the ground reaction forces, the forces you're creating here, are coming from the extension of the ankle, knee, and hip flexor. We call that triple extension. That's why I named 3X pitching the method that Top Velocity teaches. It's a whole method, a scientific method, using scientific principles to teach you how the actual movement works through the understanding of science. Not many organizations or not many methods are using science. They're guessing, and they're making things up with the lack of education. So let's go more into that. You're going to hear organizations talk about things like, how do we get started? You know, like you lift the leg. Obviously, we all know lift the leg. And out of a balance point, some people address a balance point, some people don't. I'm not a big fan of a balance point. But as we lift the leg, obviously we've got to create momentum. We've got to create energy. But this is where most organizations are clueless. And I would say 99% of them are clueless, because they'll tell you that to move forward out of your leg lift, it's just something that magically happens. Like, for example, you'll hear things like, you'll start falling forward. Well, that's not real science. There's nothing in science that falls forward. Falling is down. Gravitational movement is down. That's scientific law. Other organizations may even say you slide at a leg lift, or you drift, I've heard. You drift. There's sliding or drifting is based on a current. So there has to be some type of air current or water current to make you slide or drift. More probably on the drift side. That's the pure definition of drift. Sliding means you're sitting down on a slick surface and you are being subjected to an angle. So gravity is taking you down, but the surface is slick, so you're gliding along the surface, not so much in a down angle. So we're not really sitting, we're standing, and the surface isn't slick, so my feet aren't sliding. So I'm technically not sliding. Also drifting, I'm standing here, there's no current, there's no gust of wind, I'm not in water that's gonna take me forward. That's important to understand. I'm not just saying that to make fun of those methods. I'm telling you that because that's not a good understanding of how this works. Scientifically, you need to know that something has to happen to make you go forward, and it's definitely not a drift and it's definitely not a slide. What is it? And this is where you have to answer the question, because if you don't answer the question, you don't learn something. When you're trying to learn a movement, and this is a kinetic movement and it's a chain reaction, if you don't understand big chunks of the chain and what's going on, then you don't truly understand the movement, and then you could be doing things that work against the ability to optimize the movement. And we see this everywhere in baseball. People have a poor understanding of huge segments of the movement, and then all of their coaching or their work is in a poor understanding of optimization or in an overcompensation of the movement, which the problem with that is that's where the injury comes from. So this lack of understanding. So if you can't answer the question, you truly do not know the scientific answer to how after I lift the leg do I move forward, then there's a good chance you're not going to understand what you're doing through the rest of the movement or how to optimize the rest of the movement. And then you're going to be overcompensating, you're going to lead to injury. So what am I doing? I'm lifting the leg. And why am I lifting the leg? Because I want to move. If I didn't want to move, I'd leave my leg down. I lift the leg so I can move. That's why it starts the movement. It allows me to move. I keep one leg on the ground because I want to stay connected to the ground, because the ground gives me the ability to move. That's ground force. But to move, there is only one way to move, and it is a pushing action. Yes, there is a fall, but that will only take me down. I am moving forward, so there is a push. So a push is a force, and it's an exertion of force. If you don't want to say push and you want to say you got to exert force, that's fine. But there's an exertion of force. Where am I exerting force is the question. I'm exerting force in the only leg on the ground, once again, because it's the only place I can exert force and have real leverage to move and you know, create momentum. That exertion of force is going to have to come somewhere in this leg. Let's just go up the joints. The ankle can really only extend. Right now, I don't need extension, I'll go up. The knee can only extend. Right now, I don't need extension, I'll only go up. The hip is the next movement coming up the chain that has the ability to move not just an extension, but an abduction. So that's where we're going to exert force. So we're going to lift the leg, and we're going to exert an abduction force like this, but the foot is tamped or held down. So when I create an abduction force, that is the push that moves me forward. So I'll lift the leg, I'll create the abduction force to move my hips forward, and then I can start to use gravity in combination with that to create this forward momentum. So I'm gonna lift, I'm not gonna drift, I'm not gonna slide, I'm not gonna fall. Maybe I'll fall a little bit, but definitely none of the other ones, because that's not scientific, or that's not a good scientific explanation of what is happening. I'm going to push because I have to exert force in my hip to get my momentum building and going forward. Once I do that, I like to say move forward and down the same rate. So for every inch forward, I move an inch down. So that means as I'm exerting force to go forward, I'm going to flex my ankle, knee, and hip flexor, I call that triple flexion, to move down in the process. And the goal is I want to eventually get to a position where, just like the studies say, I can apply the extension forces in the drive leg that will create the peak ground reaction forces that will flow energy to my core. Once again, that's all scientific principles that are in case studies. So initially, we exert force in the hip abduction, glute medius, piriformis, TFL, to move my hip forward. Yeah, I don't want to lean into that. I want to keep myself, my trunk vertical, and I want to create that movement. Then I want to move forward and down the same rate, because my goal is to eventually get the drive leg in a linear position, pointing as close to the target as I can, so I can then apply the extension, the ankle extension, the knee extension, and then as I move into rotation, because I'm going to trigger rotation by opening my front foot slightly, then I can go into knee extension to also power pelvis rotation. But I can't peak extension of the ankle, knee, and hip, like the studies are telling me I have to do to create energy from the legs and move it to the torso, if I don't get the shin in angle to the target. This is no different than a sprinter getting on the block. He gets the ankle in a linear position because he wants to move forward, not up. And then he has to do the same thing. He has to go ankle, knee, hip extension. So yes, this is what pitchers are doing. Yes, every single pitcher in the game is doing this. Now, some pitchers aren't applying as much angle extension. They're trying to extend, but they're not getting into as much joint extension as other pitchers. Some pitchers can get into full joint extension. Some pitchers can't, but they are still attempting to extend those joints to peak forces, to energy flow or move energy up into their body. So everyone is doing it, but some are getting more of a full extension angle out of it than others, because some have tighter joints, muscles around the joint. Some have more mobility there, so it's easier for them. It's just depending on the size of the athlete, but they're all doing it. So once I get that peak energy flow or peak forces moving up and linear through the hip, then I can go to the upper body and start to work on the upper mechanics, like hip to shoulder separation. The front leg is going to catch that momentum, like the studies show, and then it's going to try to block that, hold on to that energy, and push back into it through its extension, ankle and knee, to then launch the energy up into the upper torso, because that's what the first study said. The back leg's propulsion pushes it in. The front leg's extension pushes it out. So I hope that clears up the poor understanding that we see in the game today. The crazy thing is I've been teaching this for almost 20 years, and very few organizations have grasped or been willing to dive into the science like I have. They've been fighting the science for 20 plus years, refusing to learn it. Don't know why, and I would encourage the industry to be more open to learning science, be more open to getting certifications in the science, getting higher education in the science, so we can all speak universally through similar scientific terms, so everyone who's learning from us can understand our differences, as opposed to those refusing to be educated and just making it up and going off of anecdotal observations of maybe elite pitchers and what their opinions of how they think they move. So you should as well, if they're not going to do it, if coaches are just not going to do this, I recommend that you as players also do that as well, and really search hard to find those that are actually teaching you scientific principles, as opposed to just the stuff that they've made up that they think sounds different, so therefore they can make it seem more interesting. But this is how it works. So, like, once again, this isn't me. This is what the science is saying, and we just apply the science really well at Top Velocity, and we've built a whole method on it, and we spend a lot of time educating people on it, because that's where you're gonna have more success, because the reason it's more scientific based is because there's more educated people behind it, and they're using big groups of people when they study it to have better sample sizes to give you more higher probabilities that these principles are working or not working. And it's always the better way to go. So I hope this helps you understand and clear out all the chaos and bad information out there, and you can really start to understand the physics of how this works. So if you have any comments, love for you to post your comments below. If you have any suggestions for any more information that I can teach you, I will, but there's tons in our programs for you to start learning. There's many ways for you to get started. TopVelocity.net, camps, online training, online education, all of our product development that we've put around the science. It's all there. Check it out. See you on the next show.